Hey everybody, Dr. Luke Holter here, and I wanted to personally welcome you to the first night of the Samuel Conference. Here at the Samuel Conference, we have a goal. We didn't want to just have goosebumps and fire tunnels, but we wanted to equip the everyday believer with hearing the voice of the Father for themselves. We have this crazy idea here that you can actually be normal and anointed. And so we wanted to offer the everyday believer the opportunity to get trained and equipped. So join us Saturday morning at 10 a.m. right here in this sanctuary for the Samuel Institute. It's an introductory course to train you how to hear the Holy Spirit. No one is born into this gift perfect. We all have to learn, we all have to be trained, and we all have to grow and mature in the gift. That's why we call it the Samuel Institute and the Samuel Conference, because Samuel started the very first school of the prophets. So we want to train and equip you and pour into you that are attending this conference. Join us as well Saturday night at 6 p.m. for our evening service, Sunday morning 10 a.m. for our morning service, and then Sunday night at 6 p.m. for our final evening service. Now we want to encourage you to participate. Go all in with us at this conference this weekend. We are going to chase heaven this weekend, and we are going to walk in new levels of revelation and Holy Spirit power and authority in the name of Jesus. Now, will you please join us for an amazing time of worship with our Spring First worship team? God bless.
Would you stand to your feet as we get this thing started? Come on. We come to praise the name of the Lord. Somebody give a shout of praise.
Yeah.
it again. All my life. Sing that again.
And all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, we declare your goodness. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am made, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh,
Oh,
Wanted to let go of and you don't know how to. And for people who are online, for people who are in house, just lift your hands and he's gonna help you let it go tonight. We're gonna sing that chorus again, and by faith just receive the freedom that he's already paid for. It's that easy, it's that simple. We can let go. It's easy to let go. Can't stand, no, it's easy to let go.
lift your hands to the Lord. The Holy Spirit's speaking to us tonight, saying that there's things that we got to let go of. Father, we give you permission tonight to search our hearts. Holy Spirit, please remove from us anything that hinders love. Father, anything that hinders growth or development in your presence. We break any agreements that we have with things that hinder love, that hinder intimacy, that hinder relationship. Father, we repent for any area where we've had preconceived ideas or where we've boxed you in. Father, where we've brought any baggage, God, where we've forced others under the filter of our pain or our wounds, Holy Spirit, baptize our eyes that we may have dove's eyes, that we may see how you see. Baptize our hearts, Holy Spirit, that we may feel what you feel. Baptize our mouths, oh God, that we would speak life, that we would break any agreements we have verbally, God, that we would no longer agree with hell, but that we would agree with heaven over our lives and the lives of others. Father, give us a divine awakening tonight. Give us a divine awakening tonight. Father, we need no thing to come between us and the throne. So Father, any baggage we brought in, any anger in traffic, Lord, any disappointment, Father, any relationship breakdown, God, any last ditch attempt effort by the enemy to distract us through conflict, Father, we surrender at your feet. Father, may each one of us tonight be good soil to receive a seed. May it not fall on bad soil, but may it fall on good soil. May it take root and produce fruit. In your name we pray. Amen. 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 Isn't God good? Give it up for our incredible worship team, Spring First Worship. I'm just telling y'all, you can't pay for that kind of worship. But we're going to try. Amen. We're going to give you an opportunity. I wanted to thank everybody that came tonight, that's here for the weekend, that's registered. We've had a little over 350 registrants online that are coming various days during this conference. And I want to welcome you officially to the First Samuel Conference here at Spring First Church. I want to thank y'all. God's put a passion in our hearts to train and equip. This is my 20th year of full-time traveling ministry, teaching and equipping on the prophetic. We've had tens of thousands of students go through our school, get trained and equipped on how to prophesy, hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. But I just wanted to say welcome to this amazing conference this weekend. We've got amazing speakers. We've got Bishop Bill Hammond, Lou Engel, and myself, if I had to toot a horn. I would also like to acknowledge first, before anything, my beautiful smoking hot Filipino wife. Y'all can be seated in God's presence as she stands. You want to stand? It's my queen. There, wave at everybody, baby. Gemma, you stand up too. You wave at everybody. This is my little half Filipino daughter. A little half Norwegian, half Filipino princess. She's a Norgipino or a Filoegian. We have these cards at the table, and we're going to be passing them out as well to take offering tonight. How many of y'all know that it takes finances to make the kingdom run? Now, I'm not going to give you this big, long guilt trip playing Sarah McLachlan in the background. In the arms of the angel. I'm just going to tell you, we need your money. Okay, like, I'm not going to manipulate you. I'm not going to drive you through this long 45-minute sermon of giving. If you receive a prophet, you get a prophet's reward. And what that means is if you sow into the value of the prophetic word, your benefit is that you get the fulfillment of that word. You get the full inheritance associated with that word. And it opens up more in your life. And so I want to give you a chance to give. There's real cost, real finances that we're pouring into this. And this region is worth it. Amen? We've got people watching online. I want to go ahead and put up the slide if you're going to give. We've got information on giving, on how you can give. If I could have the ushers come forward. Or how are we doing? We got ushers? Yep, we got them. If we can get the Urshers to come forward. Every Ursher. And we've got these cards that they're going to pass out. If you'd like to give, you can put on there if you'd like to do a one-time gift or a monthly gift. Now, I'm just going to be very transparent with y'all. The history of the prophetic movement in Houston, Texas for conferences, my wife and I did these for years. And what tends to happen is we get people that are curious and excited but don't necessarily buy in. And I'm just telling you, the prophetic and the work that's being sown in this region is worth the investment. Amen? A few of you? Cool. Awesome. Four of you. That's great. But I wanted to give you an opportunity to give tonight. Do we have those slides available to put on the screen for giving? Yes? Let's crank them up. Ushers, if I could, are you right there? All right. The ushers are going to go ahead and pass out the cards through the aisles. We want to bless the worship team. We want to bless the people who have volunteered here at Spring First. We want to, of course, bless Lou and Bishop Bilhaman and bless everybody that's involved. So we're going to give you a chance to give. If you'd like to receive one of these cards, you can lift a hand. If not, they'll still pass them down the aisle and make it awkward. Cool. We have resource tables as well in the back. Gracie, if you would come take this. Thank you. We have resource tables for Bishop Bilhaman and myself. I encourage you, go to Bishop's table. I would rather he go home with no books. I live here, so I can take him to my garage. But you can buy books from my table as well on training and equipping. I've got a book came out that it's called Filthy Fisherman, came out on Charisma House on how God uses weakness for his glory. My testimony's in this book, and it basically, the topic of this book is how to break shame-based Christianity off your life. Amen? And then we've got this book that just came out that actually my bishop, he's my spiritual grandpa, wrote the foreword for this, The Art of Hearing the Father. It's 300 pages of training and equipping on understanding the prophetic, on dreams, on visions, on intercession, on intimacy with Christ. It's not enough to just be anointed, but you also have to have godly character. Amen? And so we're training and equipping on that. So who would like a book? Yeah? Okay, they're for sale back there. Go ahead, you can grab one. Thank you so much for committing. I'm kidding. Come up if you want this book right here. Come on. I'm not going to throw it. Come on. There we go. I got one more right here. If anybody, there we go. There you go. And so the ushers are going ahead and they're passing that out. Amen? We got it? All right. Everybody, close your eyes. Keep them closed.
Your breath. Make a wish. Count to three.
Come with me and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look and you'll see into your imagination. We'll begin with a spin. Traveling in the world of my creation, what we'll see will defy explanation.
The title of my message tonight, I might have taken some of y'all on a memory lane right there. I grew up watching Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. Y'all know that movie? Not the new weird one with Johnny Depp. But the OG one, right? The original Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. That's Gene Wilder singing that song. It's a beautiful song. But the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit speaks to me and gives me messages to preach and gives me things that are on his heart, the Lord will often use things that are a part of my culture, a part of my life. The Holy Spirit speaks to you in a way you understand, which is not in Old English. I know a lot of times in church culture, we get things that are like, thus thou verily unto thee this day the Lord hath said. That's great. That's a version of the Bible that people become comfortable in speaking. But oftentimes we quote things in King James because we feel it makes us look more anointed and powerful. But how God speaks is through the normalcy of your everyday life. Amen? If we could get the lights brought up a little bit in the sanctuary, that'd be great so I can see these beautiful faces. Amen? Some of y'all need to chill out. Y'all are quiet in here. Like, if you hold still long enough and be quiet, you're not going to get a word, okay? We're just going to let the Holy Spirit. Some people, if you're up in the balcony, y'all can come down. These rows are saved for people that pre-registered, but if there's empty seats, y'all can come down and grab and open a seat. So we're going to have a fun time this weekend, but the Lord speaks to me through the things that I let into my life, the things that I'm consumed by, and some of that is 80s and 90s movies and music. Amen. The thing that I learned when I studied about, when I got my PhD in biblical theology, is that God showed up in the pagan world as much as he did the temple. With the forefathers of our faith that God called, Father Abraham, y'all know that? Father Abraham had many sons, right? Many sons had Father Abraham, right? If you grew up in church in the 70s and 80s and 90s, you knew that jam. Well, Father Abraham was a pagan moon worshiper. And he was so faithful to the God of the moon that it made God jealous. And God called him and said, Abraham, I want you. And he said, okay. And God accounted it to him as faith. And that's a forefather of our religion. Hello? He called a pagan moon worshiper who was faithful. God shows up in, sometimes when he speaks, it's not on Christian TV. I don't know if y'all knew that. It may not be on Christian radio. It may be in the normalcy of your life. Amen, a few of you? Man, thank you for those good amens in this Methodist conference this weekend. Good Lord. I preach the Methodist church is more alive. Now, come on. I know it's cold outside, but let's get it hot in here, okay? I'm just saying. Good Lord. So the Lord gave me this message through, the Lord spoke to me one day and said, I'm in my office meditating on God, got my word open, doing word studies, going after it. And the Lord says, I want you to watch Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. And I was like, you do? I was like, yeah. And I was like, okay, let's get into it. Turned on the Apple TV, watched Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. And the whole time the Holy Spirit's speaking to me through this movie. And so this message tonight is titled Willy Wonka. I believe strongly that the Lord wants me to release three things tonight. A lot of times when we talk about the prophetic, people get the goosebumps or they think about fire tunnels or they think about all these different things that we're going to do. But what God wants to do above those experiential things is to deposit in your spirit a power and a knowledge that would get you to walk active in the gift, to produce fruit, to go out into the world and prophesy mysteries over the lost, to prophesy mysteries over those that are dying, that are hurting, that are broken, to go out into the LGBTQ community and prophesy identity over people that need to hear it, that it goes beyond these charismatic, like mouth-frothing prophetic conferences where we're become lustful over an experience. We believe that God wants to move in power and authority through your life, that you would prophesy mysteries. But we gotta come out of our box. I'm just telling y'all, it's great to have a Sunday morning or a Sunday evening or a Wednesday evening where somebody prophesies and we're like, yeah, you got it. But there's something bigger than that. This should not be the primary location where you experience the prophetic. It should not be in the church. This is where we come together as a family and encourage one another in the prophetic. But this is not the primary location where we walk in it and experience it. It's meant to be out in the world, transforming culture. We wonder why the church has lost influence. It's because we've learned to shut our mouths. Or we exert it in the wrong way and we exert our opinion over God's. We wind up being known for political affiliations instead of speaking life-changing words from heaven. Listen, I've been in some churches that no longer churn out Christians, they churn out Republicans. I'm just telling y'all, I'm meeting Christians that know more about the political party than they do what's required of them by God in the Word. Jesus was not a Republican, and he was not a Democrat. He's kingdom. And that's how we have to operate, and the world is meant to be influenced by the bride, but we've come into a peace treaty with disappointment as the bride because we've lost our wonder. Because we've been sucker punched in life and it's caused us to stop daydreaming with God because we're fearful of the other shoe dropping. But I'm telling you, God's gonna restore wonder in the church again. And he's gonna inspire you to step out of your comfort zone and at your job, begin to prophesy over people. in the supermarket, begin to prophesy over people, at the gas station, begin to prophesy over people, and watch divine relationships form and change the planet. Every powerful relationship I speak into, senators, state legislators, members of Congress, people that we speak into the lives of, didn't come from a book signing at Barnes & Noble or from pulpit ministry. It came from me being obedient at an HEB on a Tuesday at 2 p.m, not wanting to be bothered. And the Holy Spirit's like, you got a word for this guy. And giving in. But there's three things I believe the Holy Spirit wants to release over you tonight specifically. And that is, one, witty inventions. Two is a spirit of wealth, which is not just finances. It's peace, wholeness, health. It's all, it's total sozo. Number three is a release of the spirit of creativity. That once again, there'd be a rebirth of renaissance in the body of Christ. That we would step out into a new level of creativity through the arts, through music, through entertainment, through your own gifting. Everyone in here, you've been given a gift by God. It just depends what your gift is anointed by. Is your gift anointed by something other than the Holy Spirit? Your gift means talent. God's given you a talent. And if you're damaged, wounded, and unhealed, then that means that's the thing that's baptizing your talent. Which means people get elevated in a gifting and then they fail and we wonder why they failed. And the whole time we elevated their gifting but not the anointing. It's the same reason that people that are not discerning use suspicion instead. Let me just tell y'all, suspicion is not a gift of the Holy Spirit. I know in the prophetic it is. People are like, I don't know about that guy. He's kind of weird. And it's like, well, maybe you're weird. Or maybe he just smells funny or wore something weird. Who knows? But people no longer rely on discernment. Instead, we rely on suspicion, which is dangerous because we could miss a blessing. The difference between discernment and suspicion is this. Discernment allows the image bearer to keep their God-given dignity. Suspicion removes it. It removes the dignity of others. It removes the element of warring on spiritual things. But this is what kind of got me going. The Holy Spirit said, look, I want my church to get back into a place where they're creative, where they're creating new things, where they're starting businesses, where they're creating new things that are outside of their realm of influence. That's the history of the Bible, is champions in Hebrews 11 were completely unqualified to do what God called them to do. Each one of them was an epic failure and made it into Hebrews 11, the Hall of Fame. Moses was a poor communicator who murdered an Egyptian out of God's will, ran from God, was macking on some honeys at a well. And we're like, it's so spiritual. He learned to lead people by leading sheep. No, he ran from his calling and God still met him there. That's what happened. God still found him there. And then on a mountaintop, God's writing the Ten Commandments in tablets of stone with his finger. Moses is holding these tablets and it says, thou shalt not murder. Moses already killed a guy. He's already murdered. God picked a law-breaking murderer that was a poor communicator to communicate the law. Hello? What's your beef? You're like, well, I didn't go to Bible college. So what? Yeah, I went to Bible college, but I learned most of what I know from the street. 7 years in drug addiction, 7 years working for a drug dealer. 7 years of debt collection, working for a drug dealer, and most things that I learned from the street, and then God anointed it when I came into the kingdom, and I found different things. Now I'm from the south side of the kingdom. You don't need a PhD to do what God's called you to do. You need a will and a drive, and you need to agree with heaven that you're worth living in. Most Christians disqualify themselves because they don't feel equipped. Good, you're not. People are like, I don't feel sufficient. You're not. Like, you are not sufficient. And if you ever get to a place where you believe you are, you're in trouble. The fact that you don't have what it takes to do the big thing that God put in you shows that you're prime real estate. It means it can only be him. It means you don't get any of the glory. Every morning I wake up and all these great testimonies we have are a sign and evidence that I don't have what it takes. Speaking into worlds and into things that I am not qualified or educated in, but God is. But I started this study and the Lord said, read Proverbs 8:12. And this is what it says in the King James. Proverbs 8:12 says, I, wisdom, dwell with prudence and find out knowledge of witty inventions. We need to stop and meditate on that for a second. I find knowledge of witty inventions. There's things still yet to be created that rest in the heart of God that you can pull on. Think about it. Secular scientists, secular doctors, secular engineers, they have a limit to the level of their revelation. We don't. Because we serve a God outside of time, the uncreated God of the universe, that we can reach up into heaven and pull information out of heaven. That God can look at a person who's humble and open and willing and deposit a secret in them, and they can receive their golden ticket. You got to get over yourself, though. You got to admit that you're worth living in, that God picked you. I get it. Like, we were saved, sinners saved by grace. But at some point, you've got to live on the other side of Calvary. Yes. We got to come out of shame-based Christianity. Yes. We got to, listen, I used to read the Bible and I would look for my identity in every sinner and every story that met with Jesus until one day the Holy Spirit rebuked me. And he said, when are you going to stop identifying with the sinner in the story and start identifying with Jesus? We're always the villain, begging for God to show up. But there's more. Proverbs 29:18 says, where there is no, and it translates this to prophetic vision, where there is no prophetic vision, the people cast off restraint. But blessed is he who keeps the law. And the law there breaks down to mean the body of prophetic teaching. People that have no prophetic vision cast off restraint. They lose hope. And when you lose hope, you lose morality. Because when you lose morality, you step into desperation. And desperation produces entitlement. And entitlement breeds poverty. You believe you're owed something, and so you force it instead of letting God bring it in. Some of you might be unpacking this stuff for a little while after this event. I'm not saying because I'm deep. I'm saying because that was the Holy Spirit right there. Landing in my notes. The Lord let me see a real vision of this. I was preaching at a conference up in Canada, and there's this sweet old UPC lady. You all know UPC, United Pentecostal, right? They all wear suits, and like the ladies got their hair up in the bun, and they got the long hair and the dresses and no makeup. And they're like, we don't believe in being showy, but then they wear like little My Fair Lady hats, and like they're bedazzled everywhere. This sweet elderly woman was at this conference, and she's at the front row, and she's spinning around in her long dress, and her hair comes out of the bun, and it's like this long hair, and she's dancing and going after it. And I'm watching the worship team, and it's one of those conferences that I'm a little uneasy at. And what I mean by that is, yes, I know that I'm called to be a prophet, so I speak at prophetic conferences all over the world, and some of them are weird. Can I just be honest with you? Some of them are weird. People wear like capes and carry swords and have like 9 Star of David tambourines and like wear Jewish stuff that Jewish people don't wear because it's made up. People wind up looking like a Jewish Gandalf at some of these things. None shall pass. It looks weird. Usually that's out of low self-esteem, overcompensating for not feeling anointed enough. God wants to get us to a place where we're healthy. Amen? So I'm at this conference, and she's spinning around, and I'm watching the worship team play, and all of a sudden I see everything in this 3D x-ray form, which is really strange, and I'm having a vision, an external vision, which is like a movie playing right in front of your face. Two types of visions, internal and external. Internal is called a divine imagination, where you daydream with God, or he shows you pictures in your mind, or sometimes I see a hand writing a sentence, that'll be a picture in my mind. It's a divine imagination, it's an inward vision. Then there's an outward vision, which is like a movie right in front of your face that you believe you could reach out and touch. It's not imagined, it's not, oh, it's like that and I'm imagining it. It's you believe it's there and right in front of you. And I have this open vision, this external vision, and I can see all the sound waves coming off the instruments. And as people are singing the worship songs, I'm seeing their vocal cords, and I'm seeing in this 3D x-ray form all these musical frequencies and notes coming right off the platform. And I watch in the supernatural as these waves hit this woman. And in the natural, she reacts as soon as the waves hit her. I see it in the supernatural. As soon as they hit her in the natural, she falls over, holding her arm, laughing and crying and rolling on the ground. And I'm like, what in the world is going on? So she goes to the doctor, she leaves, and she winds up contacting the pastor there in Ottawa, I think it was. And she contacts the pastor there, and we find out that she's healed. She had a tumor on her arm, on the bone of her arm. So you couldn't see it in the natural, but it was attached to her bone, a tumor. And so I was like, Lord, what did I see? And he goes, Google it. And I was like, Google it. I got the Bible. And he goes, Google it. I was like, okay. I advise people sometimes don't Google stuff. Right? Like if you have a medical issue, don't Google it. But I went to Google, and this is a real thing that surgeons use called sonic surgery. It's a real medical device. It's not outside the realm of normal medicine. And they use it, and this is what they use it for. It penetrates skin, muscle, nerves, joints, all that stuff, doesn't damage anything, and they use it to break apart tumors that grow on bones. And so I was like, Lord, science is proving you. And he goes, no, baby, I'm proving science. He's like, they're catching up, but I'm doing things in the supernatural that I've been doing for thousands of years that they're just stepping into now. It's just humanity and their finite minds didn't latch onto it until this time. But it's something out of my infinite mind that I've been doing for as long as I've needed to with humans. And it got me on this rabbit trail where I started going. I'm like, okay, divinely inspired inventions. So I start looking about people that discovered medications, technology that were not equipped to do it, that God gave them a download to do it. There's a guy named Gary Starkweather. He got injured in a truck accident. His back was all jacked up. He was on painkillers and became depressed and hopeless. Didn't know what to do with himself. So he prayed and he read through Genesis and he had a dream and God gave him a dream about technology. So he started drafting the things that he was seeing in his mind, the drawings of the pictures, the shapes, the symbols, started researching these things. And Gary Starkweather, you can Google all this and read it, invented the laser printer from a dream that God gave him. The laser printer came from a dream that God gave Gary Starkweather. Works for Xerox, Apple, like all these different companies, still employed, still designing things from revelation. People that are not qualified to do it. He made millions of dollars inventing this tech. And he's a believer. Did you know that money in the hands of a believer is a sword against injustice? You know, that's how we fund the kingdom. That's how we help widows. That's how we spare the orphan, is by us squishing our money together that God's anointed and pulling people out of poverty. The church historically used to be welfare. We didn't like that though. We gave it to the government. We got robbed of a blessing. But God's strategically placing kingdom philanthropists back into their positions in the body of Christ that would sow and do these things. Nurses that were God-fearing Catholic nurses that stumbled upon medication like penicillin. That came by an unqualified Catholic woman that was just beginning studying nursing. Found it in the shell of a rotted orange. That's where penicillin came from. Somebody was like, I'm so sick, I'm gonna eat this mold in this orange. Like, how many of y'all know that's desperation? And you better be getting nudged by the Holy Spirit to be like, I feel real sick from this cut, I better eat that. Like, discovered penicillin. I met a man that barely graduated high school. Never went to college. Flat broke growing up in Minnesota. Didn't know what he wanted to do with his life. Couldn't keep a job. So this is what happened. He went and he found a chicken. I know it sounds like the setup for a joke. He bought a chicken. And he learned everything he could about that chicken. Took the chicken's eggs, got a couple more chickens, built himself a little handmade chicken coop, had a few more chickens in there, started taking their eggs and selling organic eggs off the side of the highway in Minnesota. Just selling organic eggs just to make a living, just to make it, just to pay his bills, to make ends meet. Does that for years. His chicken farm grows and grows, gets a little bit bigger, nothing crazy, nothing super prosperous. And then Tyson Chicken moves into town and says, we need somebody locally that understands the behaviors of chickens to run this plant. So he starts there, doesn't get hired right away to run the plant, but works his way up the ladder, starts running the Tyson Chicken plant, making great money. His kid gets sick, is in the hospital with a rare, incurable disease. And he met with the doctors, and they said, it will cost millions of dollars to try an experimental medication to save your son's life. If it works, it may not work. So he goes home that night, and he prays, and he says, Lord, I need $1 million idea. Some of y'all are too afraid to ask for that, or you don't think you deserve it. It's not for you to keep. It's for you to give. So he has a dream of numbers and symbols and shapes. Goes to Google, enters it in Google, doesn't know what it is. Google's a scientist, calls a science lab and goes, I need to meet with a scientist. He meets with a Christian scientist, not a Christian scientist, but a Christian scientist, just to be clear on that. Meets with them, submits his drawing, and they're like, where did you go to school? And he's like, I didn't. And they're like, you dreamt this up? And he's like, yeah, and they said it's a chemical compound for an adhesive. So he rents a space and starts going over what he's going to use it for, praying and asking God. God gives him a dream on what to use it for, and he invented a product called frog's tape. Y'all know frog tape? Green painter's tape? Spirit-filled believer that got that in a dream. Not qualified. Now is working on Alzheimer's research and is in stage 2 clinical trials of a medication that came from a dream as well that can recover 25% of lost memory in Alzheimer's patients. It's slated to bring in $500 million a year. Who's doing this stuff? You're not. Why not? Why aren't you? Well, I'm just a small person from a small place and a small family. We got lots of reasons not to try. How about you find one to try? You could have a dream tonight that God gives you, and it could be about a valve on a baby bottle that becomes standard on every baby bottle in the world, and you become a multimillionaire. There's these ideas floating around in the atmosphere. There's these golden tickets that God has deposited, waiting for people to stumble upon them. But when Charlie found his golden ticket in Willy Wonka, it wasn't until he bowed low in humility and found value in the gutter and pulled the coin out of the gutter and then went and bought the Wonka bar and got the golden ticket. It wasn't until then. See, God loves you enough to not promote you. He loves you enough to not promote you before your character is ready to contain the promotion. He cares about your longevity. Isn't that good? Some of us have been like, well, why are these guys succeeding? Because either it's the flesh or they were ready. God could be testing your flesh. I had a dream where I was walking through hospitals with the Holy Spirit. And I was in a terminal ward, and as we're walking through hospital rooms, we're walking, and I'm seeing inside every hospital room, I'm seeing people that are terminally ill, and I can see this black mass, and I see their body in that same 3D x-ray form, and I can see a black mass, and in that black mass, there's a pinhole light that gets brighter and brighter as I get close to their body, and I can see it's a keyhole. And all of a sudden, in this dream, Jesus and I were no longer in hospitals, but I was in the bedrooms of Christians. And I could see sleep bubbles over people's heads, dreaming of keys and waking up and dismissing their dreams because they didn't understand them, because it seemed too weird. Listen, biblically, dreams are the most common way that God spoke to people. If he could speak to wicked kings in dreams, he can speak to you. As his children, you should hear much clearer. You didn't just eat tacos too late. Okay, I know some of us get those weird dreams. And there's some dreams that are fleshly and weird. Some that are torment from spirits. And then there's some that are from God. And it's pretty easy to judge which one is which by the fruit of the dream. But God's trying to give us ideas. But look at Willy Wonka and the chocolate factory. The golden ticket. He stumbled upon it when he bowed low in humility. But look at the other kids that won. You got Charlie Bucket, right? He was the humble kid that grew up in poverty. He knew nothing about wealth. All of his grandparents slept in the same bed, right? Head to foot in the same bed. They were impoverished. They had nothing. They ate cabbage soup every night. They had no means. Then there was Violet Beauregard, the loudmouth girl. Right? That chews gum. She's like, I've been chewing this gum for 385 days. Right? And they're like, hey, Willy Wonka's taking them around. And he's like, hey, don't eat this, this candy. It's a 7-course meal, but we haven't worked the kinks out of it yet. And she's like, it's fine. If it's gum, it's for me. And she grabs it and eats it. Turns into a big old fat blueberry. Right? And they're like, oh no, we got to send her to the squeezing room. Like, we got to squeeze all that blueberry juice out of her. So they wheel her off, or they roll her off, I should say. Then there's my favorite, Augustus Goop. That fat little German kid. He's like, oh yes, I can't wait to tour the factory. And they put the microphone in his mouth and he eats the top of the microphone because he thinks it's a meatball. They're interviewing him and he's just like, he gets whatever he wants. And he goes to the chocolate river from the scene we were just talking about, pure imagination. He runs into the chocolate river and he starts drinking with his hand out of the river. And Willy Wonka's like, no, don't do that. It's purified. You can't touch it. That makes it dirty. And he's like, I don't care. And he's like eating it. And then he falls in and gets sucked up into the tube. And they're like, well, he's going to go to the, I don't remember what room it was, but where the Oompa Loompas are going to have to get him and stretch him, I think. That was Mike TV. And so then there's Veruca Salt, who is, I want a goose that lays gold eggs, right? She was a brat. Her dad bought all those Wonka bars to get the golden ticket, and she was a brat. And what happened to her? She was a rotten egg, and she fell down into the incinerator. Then there was Mike TV, who loved violence and wouldn't listen to his parents and was rebellious and loved TV too much and got shrunk down and turned into a little action figure. And then he was sent to get stretched out by the Oompa Loompas. But when you look at these kids, every one of them had a major character flaw. Every one of them that lost had a major character flaw. They all had the same opportunity to tour the chocolate factory, and the prize was you get the chocolate factory. Each one of those kids had an opportunity. Even Charlie messed up. Him and Grandpa Joe drank the fizzy lifting drink. Right? They're like, burp, burp, like burping as they're flying up, right? They get fingerprints all over the ceiling. And I love this part where they're at the end and they've got the everlasting gobstopper, right, that Slugworth was trying to get, right? He was offering money for it. And he walks up to Willy Wonka and he's like, what's going on? We finished. You know, we're the last ones here. We won. And Willy Wonka turns around and he's like, you didn't win anything. You broke the rules, Charlie. You drank fizzy lifting drink, and now Oompa Loompas have to clean that. So you didn't win, Charlie. You lose. And Charlie and Grandpa Joe are getting ready to leave, and Grandpa Joe's thinking, you know what, we can sell this to Slugsworth and get some money back for all the we've been through. See, having the wrong vision will cause you to make exceptions for yourself. But when you have the vision of the Holy Spirit, you'll act like Charlie. Charlie turned around knowing he'd be tempted out of woundedness to sell the candy. So instead, he gives it back to Willy Wonka and says, here you go, Mr. Wonka, and sets it down. And then Willy Wonka grabs it and goes, Charlie, my boy, you did it. You passed the final test. You get the chocolate factory. What a dumb idea. What does some impoverished kid know about running a multi-billion dollar chocolate conglomerate? He's had no business training. He's had no education on the economy. He doesn't know what he's doing. He doesn't know anything about engineering and making these machines and keeping them running. But he had the character to contain the promotion. Willy Wonka knew that he could teach him all those things. But what he couldn't teach was good character. And God's looking at some of us saying, hey, there's these areas of refinement that I want to take you through. I want to better these chambers of your heart so you can contain the promotion that's coming, because God cares about longevity. And so there's relationships we're walking out right now that are painful. Some are from the enemy and some are from the Lord. And it can feel the same to those that are not discerning. Some of you have asked God, help me to love better. So he sent people in your life that are hard to love. And you were like, this is not what I meant. Now, I'm not talking about abusive relationships. Get out of those. But God is giving golden tickets out. He's giving ideas, these divine kairos things at divine moments, and depositing them in people's hearts. I've started doing business consulting, prophetic business consulting. That sounds weird, but it's biblical. Joseph and Daniel and different ones in the Bible were used by kings and kingdoms to deliver and interpret dreams and deliver words that saved nations from famine, from drought, from war. That's our inheritance. It didn't die out with the apostles. It became accessible to us, even more accessible because everything from the Old Testament had to die and go into the grave with Christ and come back up through the cross, which made the prophetic more accessible, not less accessible. We have to stop prophesying out of an Old Testament model. There's not a single thus saith the Lord in the New Testament. Which means we're not killed when we're wrong. We grow. That's why the Apostle Paul says, do not despise prophecy, because we have to grow in hearing. We have to grow in our understanding. You don't get disposed of when you make a mistake. We're under a new covenant. Do you really think God's interested in punishing you for trying to please him? Is he that sick and sadistic of a father that as you step out and try? When Gemma was a little baby girl, when she was just learning to walk, and she was a cute little Michelin baby. Come up here, baby. Come here. She's 9 now. And she's a little beauty queen. She's my princess. But when she was just a little nugget learning to walk, she really was a daddy's girl since she was a baby. And she wanted to get to daddy because she knew that daddy had all the cuddles and kisses and snuggles and that I would sneak chocolate to her. When mommy said no, daddy said yes. And she was learning to walk, and she's walking towards me, and she would make these noises. She had 2 bottom teeth, and she would stick out her bottom jaw when she had to work hard. When she was learning to walk, she'd go like that, and she'd grunt with those little Michelin legs. And she fell on the carpet on the way to me. And the Holy Spirit said, I want you to get in her face and I want you to scream at her as loud as you can for falling. And I said, I'm not doing that. And he said, yeah, I wouldn't either. When we're learning to walk and hearing the Holy Spirit and we're being obedient, he's not going to punish you when you tip over. When you fall, when you get tripped up, he's not going to punish you. Okay, baby, you can go down now. Love you. She loves that. But God's not interested in punishing you. There's biblical definitions to what a false prophet is. It's not somebody who's trying and makes a mistake. It's somebody that denies the resurrection of Christ, denies that Jesus is the Son of God, walks in an antichrist spirit that draws others to themselves instead of points to Christ. It's manipulative motives. It's not somebody who's trying and then fails. That just means you got to sharpen your hearing. You got to learn to hear. Babies learn to talk. We don't extend the same courtesy to Christians. Nobody's going to get saved and come into the church perfect. We got to grow. And there's been a misunderstanding about the prophetic in church culture for a long time because we haven't had many mothers and fathers in it. We've had culture, and culture is not always the same thing as biblical principle. We got people doing things like, oh, this person's in sin, this person's a Jezebel, that person's a Jezebel, this person. You think you're a prophet just because you're critical and hard to be around. Can I just tell you, the fruit of a prophet is not complaining about everything and being critical? That's an Old Testament model, right? Jonah sat under that tree complaining. Thank God that Moses and God never agreed. Because Moses as a prophet, and Moses was a prophet. He said, oh, if all God's people were prophets. God would be like, I want to kill all the Jews. And Moses is like, don't do it. Don't you do it, God. What will people say about you? And God's like, okay. And then Moses got mad and was like, you know what? Let's kill them all and start with me. God's like, Moses, what will people say of me? Thank God they never agreed. But we need people that are listening to the Holy Spirit, that are stepping out, creating new things, stepping into new music. You can tell when you're listening to Christian music. You ever get into a rental car or something like that, a car you've never been in, and you turn it on and you're trying to find a radio station, and you know the second you found a Christian radio station? Like, you know right away. Because usually the lyrics give it away. Right? They're like, looking through a magazine, yeah. Hate myself, but I love God. Like, you're like, what is this?
You know, I would love to just listen to worship. Just put worship on all Christian radio. Like, let's do away with a lot of the weird music and let's just have Christian music. But you can tell also when you find a Christian TV show, right? Because you're watching, you're like, this seems oddly poor quality. Right? You're flipping through the channels, then you get to Christian TV and you're like, did I get a Canadian station? Like, what is this? Because you can tell right away with the acting. And when we lived in Los Angeles, I was on TBN, with the big gold thrones. You know that phrase, you can put lipstick on a pig? That's it. I was the pig. So they were like, we want you to come and talk and share about your book and share prophetically. And I'm like, okay. And then I get there and they start interviewing me and this other guy. And we're talking, and then they said, we're going to take a break. And I don't fit in. I just didn't fit in. I don't care about Christian celebrityism. I don't care about it. I want to tear it down. It's an idol. I want to be done with it. Being famous doesn't mean you're anointed. And it doesn't give you the right to speak into every situation. And so I'm there, out of my element. And they cut to a commercial break. And they're like, okay, we're going to, show and advertise. And this commercial comes on. In a world where 10 strangers find themselves trapped in a diner. They've got to decide what side of eternity they're going to live on forever. Right? And the busboy is a white guy, and his name tag says Jesus. And the people in the restaurant are like, oh, your name's Jesus? This boy's white. He's whiter than I am. And I'm so white that my friends of color bring me with them in the summertime at night to light up the way. Because my legs are translucent. I am the lamp unto your feet. Like, I don't need the spirit. You can see veins. I'm just saying. And then this lawyer comes in and he's all bony faced and he's like, my name's Beelzebub, and it's like, he's the devil and you got to decide which side of the diner you're going to live on. I burst out laughing during this commercial break and I went, who would make such a stupid movie? I was like, that had to cost like $4 million. Like, do you realize how many homeless, how many orphans, how many widows, how many starving people you could have fed? You know the kind of facility you could have built that took care of single mothers and taught them how to care for their children for $4 million. Like, that is such a waste. Who would make such a stupid decision like that? And the interviewer turned to me and said, I made it. But yours is okay. Like, I didn't mean that one. I meant like all the other ones, like that were terrible and bad and a waste. And I never got invited back. And that's okay. I'm happier for it. But God's trying to get us to be creative because of the source of our revelation. We should have the best music. Yes. We should have the best film, the best fashion, the best art, because of who inspires us. But the nature of the church is we look to the world for a model. You're lowering your standard. You're like, well, this secular band's really good. Let's sound like them. Why? Why not get in God's presence and let whatever sound comes out from heaven come out? Or people are like, well, this movie was really great. Let's make another movie that's a spinoff of that movie. No, just pray to the Lord for a creative idea and it will bring people in. But people have trouble stepping out of their comfort zones. They get talked out of it. But God's trying to deposit golden tickets, and he's trying to encourage you to prophesy. You stepping into some ideas, maybe you're called to start a business. Somebody's waiting for you to start that business. There's people you'll employ. There's people you'll reach out. There's people you'll minister to that are waiting for you to show up. But we need you to prophesy. Don't just come to a conference waiting for a word. You become the word. You get anointed. You open your mouth. You let heaven out of your mouth. You speak oracles from heaven. People come to these conferences and they're like, man, if Luke would, or if Lou, or if Bishop, if one of you do it. You have access to the same Father I do. Last time I checked, he was no respecter of persons. But again, we get into a place where we idolize others and we think they've got the key. I don't got your key. The Lord is sovereign, and there's moments where he breaks in for your benefit. But how much better would it be to live in intimacy where you're always hearing from the Father? Versus relying on him just breaking in a moment of desperation. I get a lot of emails that are like, hey, I need to hear from the Holy Spirit. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. And I'm like, well, have you gone to him? Yep. Describe to me what that looked like for you. Well, I sat in my car for 5 minutes and asked and didn't hear anything. That's not enough time. You got to spend some time with him. We got a one-night stand kingdom. Coming to me like a lady of the night, thinking I'm going to pleasure them with a word, when you got a God that wants to put a ring on your finger, okay? That wants to speak to himself, and I got people trying to bypass God and come to me. You didn't come here to get a word, and you may get one this weekend, and odds are you probably will, because that's what we flow in. But I'm just telling y'all, you are a word. You start asking him. You sit still long enough to hear him. Because my job as a prophet is to confirm what God's already told you, which means if you're not talking to him, baby, I got nothing to say to you. There's nothing to confirm. You need to be asking. You need to be moving in intimacy. You need to be searching the heart of the Father. Let the Holy Spirit in you search the depths of God and make them known to you. He does the heavy lifting and reveals it to you. Because I'm not going to be at your job. Bishop's not going to be at your job. Lou's not going to be at your job. You will. There's people that God has set aside for you to influence. Not me. I've got my circle. Hey. We need people to prophesy. How many of you all know there's identity issues going on? Can I just tell you, up is down and left is right. Good is evil. Evil is bad, or evil is good. Cats are dogs. Dogs are cats. It's crazy out there. Men are women. Women are men. People can't make up their minds. People are so trapped up in identity issues, and we mostly pick it. We mostly pick at things. We mostly come out and say, we don't agree with this. Well, if you don't agree with it, why don't you shut your mouth on the protest and open your mouth by speaking identity over people that are confused? Because prophecy is speaking the heart of the Father, which is his thoughts towards mankind. It's how he sees us. We've done things like prophesying identity over the LGBTQ community. Being like, here's a gender reveal booth. Come and line up and we'll prophesy over you, not out of a political agenda, but out of a spiritual one. We will seek heaven and we'll speak over you about what God says about you. I've been at psychic festivals and these psychic fairs and things like that where they've given us free tables and said, look, normally it's $500 a day for a table. We'll give it to you for free if you come and interpret dreams and prophesy over people. And they give us permission to call upon the name of Jesus at their psychic fairs and festivals. And everyone else will be shut down and everybody will be at our booth. Because revelation's flowing. People are finding out who they are, and it heals places where they're confused. Well, amen. Amen. We're at a time of confusion, and we need the Father that brings identity and breakthrough. And you are how heaven speaks to earth. That needs to hit somebody in this room. You are how heaven speaks to earth. You're it. We sing songs about this is what it sounds like when heaven touches earth. You are. You're plan A, and there's no plan B. God picked you and said, look, if I'm going to invade earth, it's going to be through your carcass. Yes, sir. He's looking at you going, look, I'm looking for donkeys to ride in on. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank God there's plenty in the room. Yeah. Amen. I consider myself one of them. That's it. He's just looking for somebody to ride in on. Somebody that will carry him into the place to make his name known. But God wants us to step into a place where we're changing culture. And we're seeing it. We're experiencing this where we're working with secular businesses that are bringing us in and we're talking about dreams we're having. No company I've worked with has made less than $3 million off prophetic revelation, dreams that the Lord gave me. We're working with these companies, one of which is a Fortune 500 company that I've got no education in any of it, but I got a dream and I was obedient. And I stepped out in obedience and I went and got flown into these places and said, this is what I saw in a dream. I don't know if it makes sense. And the Lord reveals new things to do with old tech they already own. A minimum of $3 million per company. We worked with one that got him into Time Magazine. Was it Time Magazine, baby? Yeah, Time Magazine last year with Invention of the Year. That came from a dream. And we helped them plan and do all these things. And I wound up negotiating a $5 million deal with Hobby Lobby for them. From a dream. I'm just telling y'all, that's not because I'm the anointed prophet of God who's been chosen. Nope. It's because I was the most obedient donkey in proximity. that's it. I was like, hee-haw, pick me, it's fine. I don't care if I'm wrong, I'll do it and step out. And God has met me at every single one of the business consulting things I've done. And God has blessed my family financially for stepping out in faith and doing that, which has thereby blessed orphans that are sex trafficked. We have two orphanages in Colombia, each one with 90 children in each orphanage. That's $1,000 a kid that we bought from pimps, and they're medically treated. They have teachers, they have educators that take care of them, real bills, real security. Helping, I don't remember how many it is now, but we help several single mothers in Houston paying their rent every month, their groceries, their bills. That came from us stepping out in faith. That's not me bragging. I'm excited that God got to do that. That I stepped out in faith and God's like, here, let me fill your hand because you're obedient. Let me fill your hand because I trust what you're going to do with it. Imagine if that was you. But instead, you know what I run into? Churches are like, must be nice to have that car. Ministry must be real good. You drive that car. It's none of your business. God blesses me. I had somebody ask me, they're like, you know, some of you all are wondering, what kind of car does he drive? Mind your business. But I've had people ask me, they're like, how can you drive something like that, you know, when people are starving in Africa and these things are happening? I'm like, how many starving people, how many orphans, how many widows do I have to help before it's okay for me to have something nice? We got to change the way we think, because the world's going to look at us and they're not going to understand us anyways. We don't need it from our brothers and sisters. God's been doing radical things, breaking us out of the box, being like, hey, and it's not that he's doing a new thing, it's that he's doing the original thing. That's what he intended for us to do, was to be in the palace halls, prophesying in the temples, prophesying in kingdoms, prophesying at gatherings of great kings and great influencers. That's where we're meant to be. We're not ordinary believers. And some of you are like, I just want to go lowly. I'm not talking about humility. We get elevated to those places because we know how to go low. It's because we go low and we are a servant of all. I don't go into any one of these meetings or any of these places going, who's willing to serve me? I'm royalty. Who's willing? Nope. I go in and I'm cleaning toilets. I'm helping move stuff. I'm helping get stuff rearranged. I'm the one that will help do it. And as I've lowered myself in the presence of the Lord, he's elevated himself in me. And the next major revival that's hitting the earth is about us decreasing and him increasing so that others can see him instead of seeing our swag. But swag isn't bad. Just saying. We've seen God do some radical things. We were in, where was it at? Oh, San Antonio. And I wound up speaking and at this church that was Catholic. They invited me, and we've spoken in Catholic, Dutch Reform, Methodist, Foursquare, Lutheran. We've spoken in circles outside the charismatic realm that have welcomed us in, that were like, we're curious. Nazarene churches, a Nazarene church that doesn't believe in prophecy or in speaking in tongues invited me in. They were meeting in a school cafeteria. And the Lord broke them out of that in 2 weeks. I gave a word. I said, in 2 weeks, you'll have over $1 million in the bank and you'll have a paid off building. And I was like, I'm not the Oprah of the church. I'm not like, you get a church and you get a church and you get a church. But it happened. 2 weeks later, a businessman they didn't know found some video of them online, went and found their office in spring. Gave them a couple $1 million, and they went and they bought a building that was being opened up to be a events center that's down the street from here. And they went in there, and it was worth several $1 million, and they talked to the developer, and they offered him, he offered them, he said, I'll sell it to you for what I have into it. I'll sell it to you for $800,000. A multi-million-dollar property, they got it for $800,000. They paid for it free and clear and still had money left over in the bank. They're a spirit-filled church now that's come out of the umbrella of the Nazarene movement. We're at this Catholic service, and you know, the first three rows were all Hispanic people that I was assuming were from San Antonio. I didn't know what to do. They're like, it's your turn. So I got up and got the mic, and I'm like, all right, let's prophesy over some people. So I call up the first three rows, start prophesying. They all are getting slain in the Holy Spirit. And as I'm prophesying, they're like, shut up, blah, blah, like start speaking in tongues, falling out under the presence of God. And I'm like I'm not in a good way of doubting Thomas. Like I'm, It's funny that God put the mantle of a prophet on my life, because I'm the dude that's checking for wires and looking under chairs, being like, is this a trick? I'm that guy. I'm like, I don't know. Give me the medical document. I'm that guy. I just want it to be real. I want it to be authentic. I'm watching these people get slain in the Holy Spirit. I don't rock people. Right? I'll barely touch you, just so there's evidence that you were knocked out by God, okay? And all these people, all three rows, got slain in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues. And the guy comes to me and he's like, none of these people have ever accepted the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But prophesying over them, the Holy Spirit saw the yes in their heart and invaded them. And they got slain and got the gift of tongues. And they were all visiting from Monterrey, Mexico, and didn't even speak English, but understood every word I prophesied in their tongue. I'm just telling y'all, as charismatics, we got to get out of this idea that we're the prettiest girl at prom. Because God is sending out wedding invitations. And it's to whoever answers. I was in Arkansas preaching at this conference, and man, it was rocking. It was what we say down south. It was hucking and bucking. And I gave an altar call for salvations and for healing. And they came down to the altar, you know, a group of them, and there was a young man in his early 20s. And I said, were you here for salvation or for healing? He said, I'm here for salvation. And the whole room jumped up and started screaming and cheering. And I was like, what is going on? Y'all know when people get saved in a church service, most of the time we're like, yay. You know, like you do a little clap and we're like, good job. Like, you know, it's happy, but it's not a football game. It's not like watching Texas Tech. Bishop Todd. But they're erupting and screaming, and I'm like, okay. And the guy's like, yeah, your testimony really ministered to me, and I decided that I want to get saved. And he goes, my mom guilted me into coming this morning, and she said, if you come see this short, tattooed, bald guy, I will never make you go to church again. And he was like, deal. So he came, and the Lord gave me a word of knowledge, and I saw his video game system. I saw the game that he was playing the night before. I told him about the last three movies he watched. It was just like a panorama right in front of my face. And he's sobbing, and he receives Christ. And about five people down is an older gentleman with a big old mustache, like a big old Magnum PI mustache. Lydia, help you out there. Reference that. He had a big old mustache, and he falls to the ground sobbing. And I'm like, what's going on? Like, why is everybody so moved? And so I said, testify. Well, why is this important? So as it turns out, this young man that came to get saved in this meeting that the Lord prophesied over was the number one meth cooker and distributor in all of Arkansas. In all of Arkansas. He had all this farmland where he had opened up silos, and he was cooking in all these silos and supplying everybody pretty much throughout Arkansas. One of the largest dealers. The older gentleman that fell to the ground sobbing was a deputy sheriff that had been pursuing him for 5 years. Watched him get saved in the meeting. And I was like, well, what's going to happen? Like, are you going to arrest him? Like, what's... Because that's a real question, right? I'm like, what's... My ADHD kicked in, and I'm like, are you going to arrest this guy? Like, what's going to happen? Bad boys. You know, I don't know what's going to happen. And he's like, no, this guy is my brother in the Lord now. I'm going to help him. I'm going to work with him. And so the sheriff's department worked with him and totally took down all of his labs, all that stuff. And this guy, this recovered meth dealer, this redeemed meth dealer, took all of his meth money that he had been hoarding in a grain silo, cash, and paid for his church's $2 million building project. And people were like, people hear that testimony and they're like, I don't know. And that's drug money. Like, that's wicked money. Did it pass through the hands of nine intercessors before it came into the building? No, it didn't. Did you? Because you should have. What do you think it looks like for God to shake the wealth of the wicked into the hands of the righteous? That's what it looks like. Pimps get saved. Prostitutes get saved. Drug dealers get saved. And they bring in all the money they earned. And it gets redeemed. What do you think built the temple? Pagan gold retrieved at war. Melted down and decorated God's temple. People are like, that's blood money. Well, I'll take it, homie. I prayed. Yes, exactly. I prayed over a hillbilly in Arkansas, real sweet guy. He was awesome. And he's like, I'm real depressed. And I was like, oh, okay, well, I'll pray for you, man. I'll pray for the spirit of joy to come on your life and for you to be happy. And he's like, okay. Comes back the next night and he's like, brother, that worked. And I was like, it did, awesome. And he's like, yeah, I felt worse after I left and I stopped at the gas station and I bought me one of them scratch-off tickets. And he's like, and I won $10,000, brother. And I was like, great. Like, and he's like, here's your cut. And I'm like, no, you keep it because I don't know, like, how that works. Give it to your church. Like, that's good. I'm not, it's a fuzzy line. I'm not totally sure. I don't. Some of y'all are like, give me the numbers. I have gotten those emails, by the way. In 20 years, I've gotten those emails. Do you know any numbers that are winning? And I'm like, no. If I did, I wouldn't be here. I'd be preaching to you from a TV in the Caribbean, eating flying fish, swimming with turtles. That would be my life. We've seen radical things. God's not intimidated by anything. And the prophetic is such a powerful tool and weapon in the hands of a believer. We've led over 2,000 Muslims to Christ in the last few years. And that's happened through prophetic ministry. We were preaching I was just in Minneapolis, and we were just recounting this whole story, me and Dave were, and where we had Muslims show up at a service at the church I was preaching at. They came, the girls were wearing full hijabs, everything. And I was like, they're sitting in the front row, and we didn't realize this, but they were students from Minnesota State University that were coming. They had planned a secret protest. They were going to stand up during the service and protest. Bad day to pick when God brings a prophet into the house. So I'm up there standing, and I'm like, I got a word for this girl in the hijab that's in the front row at the very end. And I was like, okay, Lord. So I call her up, and I start prophesying over her about her childhood, about her uncles and her brother and her family. And she starts sobbing. And all these Muslims stood up and came up with her. She got saved. They got saved. Their answer was, Jesus must be the Son of God, because there's no way that you could have known the secret details of her life like that. God showed them that he was real. Think of it like this. Moses met with God face to face. As one friend speaks to another, they spoke in a tent face to face. And there's a 1,000-foot black pillar of cloud filled with lightning and thunder and voices from around the throne when God would visit Moses in the tent. And it says that the Israelites would fall on their face to worship God because it was a reminder that God had drawn near. What if through the prophetic ministry that's on your life, you displayed such glory, such supernatural signs and wonders that it showed the world and the church, the lost, that God had drawn near and not forgotten them? We have led homosexual atheists to Christ through prophetic ministry. Things they couldn't argue with, that they're like, no, that's, you could never know that by looking at me. You know, I've had an easier time prophesying over homosexual atheists than I have Christians that have a prove it to me attitude. They'll believe, it'll be irrefutable. Christians have suspicion. Or we're just swollen on words. Some of y'all want words, but I'm just telling y'all, you're 5 words behind. I hope you're farming the ones you got, making room for this weekend. Some of you are like, I better start praying tonight. This guy's getting real. We got an invitation. I put it on Facebook. I had a dream in 2012 about a virus. About a virus coming to the world. 2012, I released it publicly on video about a dream I had about a virus. And I was taken to a hospital in the dream. And the hospital was named Blood of the Victor's Crown. And as I walked into the church, or into the building there, the hospital, I saw people hooked up to IV bags that said platelet-rich plasma. And these bags were going through these little blue lights as they were putting this, transfusion in their bodies. And then I walked into other rooms where I saw technology being created, these big blue lights that would sanitize rooms, sanitize buildings. And they were moving, like they had this slab where bodies were on, where people that were dying from a virus, where they were taking this blue light and passing it over using magnets and all this stuff. I saw this glass, this orangish yellow glass that they were using to use the blue light so it wouldn't harm the person that was performing the procedure. And I didn't know what any of it meant. 2012, it didn't make any sense to me, but I put it out there to be responsible with it. And then COVID hit in 2020, at the beginning of 2020. COVID means coronavirus. Corona means crown, blood of the victor's crown. So the blood that I was seeing, the platelet-rich plasma in the hospital, was people that were getting transfusions from people that overcame the virus. And so while mainstream Christian media is going, how come the prophets didn't know about this? God TV, Sid Roth, all these different voices are going, why didn't the prophets know about this? We did, we just weren't famous. We did, we just weren't welcomed into the upper echelon of fame. But God was speaking, and if the church was listening and not chasing fame, they would have known. But instead they turned on TBN and they turned on God TV, and these things are great. They have their purpose. They're great for getting the message out. I'm not downplaying them as an entity. I'm just saying there are areas that are unhealthy. And so people missed it. But we released this word, and I put it on Facebook. I said, listen, I had a dream in 2012 about the virus. Do I have any connections to the CDC? I got like 15,000 followers on Facebook. It's not like a bunch. It's not like a million. And I get an email. This woman's like, hey, my husband and I were atheists, and we came to your meeting in Minnesota when you preached one time, and you called us out and prophesied over us. We got saved in your meeting. Our son is the head virologist in charge of containment for COVID-19. Here's his cell number. By the way, he doesn't believe like us. But I want you to call him and tell him about your dream. I'll tell him you're calling. So I'm like, okay, it just got real for me. Because I had this dream and I was like, "Who?" I doubt anybody's gonna know anybody at the CDC. And here the guy in charge of it, it's his mom, in charge of containment for COVID-19. So I call the guy and I'm like, hey man, your mom gave me your phone number. He's like, yeah, I know she did. I'm aware. I was like, okay, that's cool. And he's like, what's it about? I don't have time. And I was like, well, and then I got a word of knowledge. And I gave him a word. I'm not telling it because this is broadcast. It's private. And I want to cover him. But I said it, and there was dead silence on the phone. And he goes, you got my attention. He goes, nobody even knows that. I just came from that situation. Nobody knows anything about it. So the fact that you knew is telling me that I need to listen to what you have to say. I said, okay, great. And I explained the dream to him. And then he brought another specialist on the phone and was like, we need to figure all this out, what this means. And I started explaining it. He goes, we're having trouble getting FDA approved to use the platelet-rich plasma from people that have overcome the virus to use it for people that are critically ill that are going to die from the virus. We're having trouble getting it FDA approved. And so I walked it out with them. I've got text message trails and audio recordings of me prophesying over the CDC. And they get it greenlit based on our conversation, because some of the tech, one of the things I was talking about, the yellow and orangish glass, it's called amber glass. The blue light I was seeing is called plasma light. And that's what they use. Plasma light kills every virus, not just COVID, but every virus. That's why big buildings and churches started buying these big, giant blue lights that would light up. There's these machines that go around. Inspire Church in Houston uses them. For 20 minutes, you hit a section of chairs and it kills every virus, everything. And the only way that you can move them, if you were to move a plasma light, is through magnets. So I was seeing new tech that's being even developed right now from that dream to treat people's bodies that have viruses, where the light is what kills it, where they don't have to take a pill, where it's the light that will kill what's in their blood because of the intensity. And so we wind up walking this out. The first place they do the very first blood transfusion for people that overcame the virus was right here in Houston at Methodist Hospital. He picked this location on purpose because we were here, he said. And then he met with Trump. He was in D.C. and he met with Trump and he told him, look, about the plasma light and using it to clean the blood. And in the science community, they call that a disinfectant. Let that sink in for a moment. They call it a disinfectant. Do you remember when Trump made that announcement about, hey, I've just been given some information that there may be a possible way to use a disinfectant to clean the blood? And people were like, he said drink bleach. Everybody laughed at that, but except for the scientific community, because they knew what it meant. They were like, oh, it's a disinfectant. It's probably a light or a treatment. And I reached out to my guy. I called him and I'm like, was that our conversation? He's like, yeah, Trump doesn't know you. He goes, but I gave him your dream. I gave him that part of tech that you dreamt up. I'm a nobody from Nowheresville that got anointed for a time and season because I was obedient and I dared dream bigger than me. We got brought up to Minnesota, my wife and I and my daughter, to meet with a biologist, virologist, inventor, lawyers, and one of the head pharmacists that works with the CDC. I'm not qualified to be there, but God is. So this is what happens. I go into the room. Everyone else is qualified. I'm sitting there. It's one of those meetings where they're like, hey, no cell phones. You can't take any pictures. I'm like taking pictures like secretly in case I go missing. I'm just saying, I don't know. There's some Illuminati business going. I don't know. I'm going to capture aliens. I don't know. But I'm just taking a photo. Proof. I was here. Don't believe I ever disappeared. But I'm standing there and all these guys are, you know, working it out, talking about the virus, talking about other things like Alzheimer's and all this other research stuff. And then I go, can I draw something on your dry erase board? And they're like, yeah. I was like, great. They're like, what is it? And I was like, I have no idea. So I go to it. The Lord just said, you have something to draw. So I get up there and I see it. It's a hand, just like this. And over these four fingers, it says Z-I-N-C, zinc. And then next to it is a sports car that can go 540 miles per hour. That's a lot, okay? And it goes 540 horsepower or miles per hour. And so I draw it, and they're like, what is that? And I'm like, I got no idea. That's up to you guys. God showed me that picture. The biologist jaw drops and goes, how do you know about that? And I said, I don't. But Jesus does. The Holy Spirit sees everything and knows all. And he goes, that's what I wrote my thesis paper on, is 540 zinc finger proteins. And he goes, but why that? Why zinc finger proteins? And so he gets up in front of everybody in the room and starts explaining it, the biologist explaining it to all of us, what zinc finger proteins are, and starts explaining it. And it's used to remove heavy metal deposits in the brain. What was happening to people early on, especially young people when COVID first hit, they were having aneurysms and strokes. They were having all these issues of heavy metal deposits being deposited in the brain. They found out also that people with Alzheimer's have heavy metal deposits in the brain, so they're looking at this as a possible therapy for people with Alzheimer's to remove heavy metal deposits from the brain, to help people that are on the verge of having strokes. This came out in a meeting that I'm not qualified to be in, that I know nothing about the scientific community. And God's like, here you go. He set a table for me. I'm no better than you. I'm just braver. That's it. I was faithful with the little and he did more. Can you hear the Holy Spirit? Yeah. Yes, you can. If you said yes to Jesus, you got the Holy Spirit living in you, baby, you are an antenna. And the thoughts of God are floating around this room right now, passing right through us. All over, because God never ceases. He's omniscient, omnipresent, the uncreated God. He doesn't need to set me down to pick you up. He can think of all of us at once. He's never silent. One time in the book of Revelation, he's silent. Heaven is. But he's speaking. The word tells us that his thoughts for you outnumber the sand of the seashore. And that scripture is in reference to one person, which means each one of you is over a seashore of thoughts to God. Think about when you go to the beach and you have specks of sand on your feet. How many million particles of sand you brush off your feet, each one symbolically representing a thought that God has about you. He's never gonna run out of good ideas about you. He's the originator of the good ideas about you. So it's about you tuning in to what's already in the atmosphere. You holding still long enough to hear him. Writing it down, being responsible with it. And don't be scared to make a mistake. God's anointed you to encourage others. 1 Corinthians 2:10 talks about it. The Holy Spirit searches the depths of God's heart and reveals those depths to us. Think about that. That's God's emotions and thoughts towards mankind. The Holy Spirit does all the heavy lifting. So all you have to do is be available. The enemy of prophecy is low self-esteem. Because it devalues the cross. It says that you know greater than God. And the purpose of prophecy is to exhort, lift up, and encourage. So low self-esteem will kill the voice of the Holy Spirit in your life. So you better get over it. If you find yourself defective, if you feel not worth it, if you feel like you're not anointed enough, not called enough, you haven't been proven enough, your platform isn't big enough, get rid of that thinking. Because there's no room for it where the Holy Spirit's taking the bride. Where the Holy Spirit's taking the church, there's no room for it. God wants to anoint you. You know what's motivated the most miraculous testimonies we have? Love. Not love for ministry, not a desire to be great or respected by my peers, but feeling the love of the Father and wanting others to feel that. That's my daily prayer. God, let them feel the love of the Father as I minister to them. That's my prayer. Not let me be great, let my book sell great, let this thing go great, let that go great. Lord, let people walk away being loved by you. Even if I don't prophesy a word, even if whatever, let them leave loved by you and feeling your love. 1 Corinthians 14 gives the rundown of the prophetic. 1 Corinthians 13 is the love chapter. How many of you know the love chapter, right? You ever been at a wedding and somebody starts quoting it? You know you're going to be there a while. You're like, love is patient. Love is kind. Can we get over this wedding? But there's a reason the love chapter 13 is before prophecy chapter 14, because love is a prerequisite to prophesy. He's giving us a love kingdom standard that keeps you anchored in love, not religious obligation, but love-motivated obedience. God's trying to implement love. Every miracle Jesus performed was birthed out of love because he saw that people were helpless and harassed. I prophesy because people are in need, not because people are curious, but because people are hungry and need to eat, or starving and need to eat, or thirsty and need to drink. They're hopeless and they need to be crowned with hope. And that's how you crown people with hope, is by opening your mouth and releasing 1 Corinthians 14:3, edification and exhortation to lift people up. Amen. If I could have the worship team come up, that would be great. If you could play something in a minor chord so everyone cries. Thank you so much. I'm just telling y'all, we're gonna have a dynamite weekend. This is the first night. You can clap, it's okay. Tonight's the first night. Tomorrow at 10 a.m., we have a session with Bishop Bill Hammond and myself. And so come to that, be here tomorrow night at 6 p.m. Sunday morning. We're going to give you all the times. We're going to communicate it up here. So pay attention when we play the information on the screens, because it will let you know what's going on this weekend. But I want to share these last two testimonies, because I believe that they're important for you in the room to seal this word up in your heart tonight. God wants to promote you, but it's not just so you have nice things. God wants to promote you to release others from bondage. God wants to promote you so you can reach down and pull people up, so you can become a stool for people to stand on. You know what my greatest desire is through equipping and training in the prophetic? It's not to be the forefather of the prophetic movement. There's already several of those. My hope and desire is that I would work myself out of a ministry, that you guys would prophesy and I wouldn't be needed, that people could bring me in for relationship to be like, Luke, we want you to come in and speak because we love you, but not needed. That you would be in your local churches prophesying healthy things, that you would be prophesying destiny over people's lives. You can bring the house lights down. We were preaching at this conference. This is when I first started doing ministry. They said, Luke, you're responsible for the first night, for setting the tone for the conference for the whole weekend. I was like, man, no pressure. Like, I still said a lot, right? You know, when somebody's new at speaking and they're like, the Lord said, it's how young people say like all the time. And I'm standing up there, like I'm standing here now, and the Lord said, I want you to prophesy over this woman. And I was like, okay. And he goes, I want you to tell her that she's precious. And I was like, no. Precious? Give me your phone number. Give me your address. give me your name. And the Lord said, I know what I'm doing. Tell her she's precious. And I was like, I don't want to do that because that's not deep enough. And I want to create faith in the room, Lord. Come on, help me out here. Telling somebody they're precious is like, God likes your haircut. It's not deep, right? It's like, he thinks you're the best. Like, it's, yes, it's encouraging, but people are like, well, can I get a little more accuracy? And the Lord said, who are you trying to impress, them or me? You. I'm trying to impress you, Father. Tell her she's precious. So I call her. I said, ma'am, the Lord said you're precious. And this woman falls to her knees and starts sobbing, just heaving sobbing. And I was like, okay, that's a very strong reaction for telling somebody that they're precious. She's overselling it. And then the rest of the word comes out. And I said, the Lord says, don't even worry. I've already got your house built. And I was like, uh-oh. Like, I take ownership for what comes out of my mouth. I'm educated enough to know that God wants us to prosper, but I'm not a prosperity preacher. I'm not making prophetic promises and then leaving and expecting the pastor to deal with unfulfilled destiny. I'm not doing that. And so words like that I take very, very seriously. And it was in me. I didn't even think about it. It just birthed out of me. And she's sobbing and she's crying. And so the pastor's like, give us your testimony. Like, what does this word mean to you? She said, I've been visiting this conference, staying in a hotel room. She said, I've been suicidal for several days. And she said, I wanted to take my own life. And I told the Lord that if I didn't get a word tonight, it was over. She said, at times I felt like God didn't even know I existed, like he didn't even know my name. She said, well, sir, my first name is Precious. It's her first, I'm asking the Lord for the woman's first name, and he's like, tell her she's precious, because that's who she is. But I over-spiritualized it and fought with the Lord. Finally, I stepped into obedience. And she said, I'm living in a FEMA trailer right now in Louisiana. I don't have a home, so I don't know what that part of the word means. She goes home weeks later, calls back the church and testifies to the pastor and says, her children and her church, she's been an old church mama for as long as the church has been around there. Her kids and her church worked behind her back and built her a brand new home from the foundation up and gave it to her free and clear. Why would the Lord spoil the big reveal 3 weeks early? Because she would have killed herself. She wouldn't have seen the goodness of God in the land of the living. She wouldn't have survived. She wouldn't have seen the breakthrough. There was another time my wife and I were preaching up in Canada. We were having trouble conceiving. Fertility clinics told us that we would never conceive, that we would never have a child. My promise is on the front row. They said, just so you know, your wife will miscarry and you'll have a very hard time getting a woman pregnant, but your wife will miscarry your pregnancies. God had other plans. But we're in Canada. We're trying to have a baby. I don't know if we had Gemma yet. No. And we're at this conference, and the Lord says, call out this woman and her husband. So I call him out, and he goes, they're children's pastors in the city, but not at this church. And I said, you're children's pastors in the city, but not at this church. And they're crying, and they're like, yeah, that's true. And I was like, okay. And the Lord says, now tell her that her ministry is a reminder of the one thing she can't have, and it's broken her heart. I don't want to say that, Lord. Tell her that her ministry is a reminder of the one thing she can't have, and it's broken her heart. Your ministry is a reminder of what you can't have, and it's broken your heart. And her husband just break. Just start sobbing. The Lord says, tell her this time next year she'll embrace a son. Nope. I ain't doing that. What if I'm wrong? God, what if I'm 1% in my flesh and it doesn't happen? I'm responsible for her shipwrecked faith, if that's the case. I don't want that burden. And this is what the Holy Spirit spoke to me, which seems so unfair. He won't violate your free will, but he'll get real close. He said, if you don't say it, it won't happen. Because the prophetic does two things. It foretells, which sees future events, and it foretells, which means speaks things into existence, sets wheels in motion to fulfill destiny and promises. That's why when you receive a prophet, you get a prophet's reward. That's the fulfillment of what you're praying for, the thing that was prophesied over you, the thing that's in your heart. So I gave in. And I said, this time next year, you'll embrace the sun. And she drops to the ground and screams, no! So there was no good altar service that day. We finished. It was awkward and weird. And I felt like trash. We went home several months later, 8 months later. We get an email, and I'm ministering for 8 months, and every place I'm ministering, I'm seeing miracles perform, people set free, prophetic words go forth, and I can hear an echo in the back of my head. No! Yeah, that's that time you missed it, Luke. That's that time that you damaged another believer. 8 months go by, she emails my wife and I and said, listen, I'm the woman you called out in Canada. She said, I was so angry at you that you called me out, and you called out the one thing I was the most bitter about. It hurt too much to even hope. That's why I fell on the ground and screamed no, because I had already hoped and been so disappointed over the years. So many false words of receiving babies from people that knew her. I didn't know her. God gave me a word of knowledge. And she goes, but I'm emailing you today to let you know that I'm 8 months pregnant. She said, I'm having a son. And I'm going to raise him as a prophetic voice to the nation of Canada. And she goes, the reason I was so hopeless, the thing you didn't know, is that I had already had a hysterectomy. She had no uterus to carry a child. And as it turns out, she still had a little piece left of her uterus that grew back. Her doctor, her OBGYN, who was Hindu, got saved, and the nurses got saved in the office. And I was like, okay, Holy Spirit, how did you do that? Like, I want to know how you did that. You took a lady with no uterus to carry a child, grew back her uterus, and somehow attached a baby to it. Like, how does that happen? She got her cycle back. How does that happen? And he goes, oh, that was easy. And I said, how? And he goes, if I can knit you together in your mother's womb, I can knit together your mother's womb. Hello? Either we believe the miraculous or we don't. There's no in between. We have Christian atheists, but we need Christians that believe in the power. Not just theology, but the power. This year, she sent us a Christmas card with five babies. Five kids. We've prayed for 39 couples to conceive. So far, the Lord is batting 100%. These are couples that came to my wife and I. We didn't go to them. We didn't go, hey, do you want a baby? Like, they came to us and were like, hey, would you pray for us to receive a child? I was just in Minnesota and got to hold a little baby girl in my arms. The doctor said would never be here. They said it'll never happen. Called them out after they just lost a baby. And I said, you're at a gravestone right now, but the Lord says, get ready because a season of celebration is coming. And CJ will come forth. What they had told no one, not even their parents, was that they had picked a nickname for the baby that they had lost named CJ. And I said, that mantle's not gone. You will get pregnant again. And I made the whole room do this on their legs, like rain sounds. But it was like the pitter-patter of little feet. And I said, the pitter-patter of little feet will echo off the halls of your home. So this last time I went back, I got to hold their baby girl in my arms, and the mom is 6 months pregnant with our second child. A woman was suicidal and hopeless, had nothing to hang on to, had no home, no place to lay her head. Another woman had no uterus to even carry a child. You want to know why it's important for all of you in this room to understand your role in prophecy? The reason is because somebody's breakthrough is on the other side of your obedience. You hold the key. There's only so many people I'm going to meet. There's only so many people I'm going to know. So out of fear, who are you holding out on? Who around you is desperate, but you just can't get over yourself? Who around you is needing breakthrough, but you're too busy collecting words for yourself? You've been hereby deputized tonight. I'm ordaining you as a prophetic voice. I'm releasing as a leader. I'm telling you, it's okay to prophesy. Get healed. If you got hangups, don't prophesy through your hangups. Get healed. Get inner healing. Prophesy through the right filter. But get up. You want the prophetic? I'm telling you right now, you get hungry for the prophetic, the first thing the Holy Spirit's going to do is convict you. He's going to start cleaning you out, getting you ready, dealing with character things, giving you dreams to address character issues you have. Say yes to the process and step into your calling. Step into your anointing and your destiny. Each one of you in this room, the point of this conference is not to impress you. It's to impress upon you that you would get out, that you would prophesy mysteries. Close your eyes. I want to pray for you. Keep your eyes closed. This is what we're going to do. I'm going to release over you something the Lord told me to release over you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Keep your eyes closed. I'm not putting anything on you. I'm calling something out of you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I'm releasing over you an Exodus 31 anointing. Exodus 31, verse 3. Verse 1, sorry. The Lord said to Moses, "See, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, son of Hur, from the tribe of Judah." And this is what the Lord's putting on you right now. This is what he's calling up in you. "And I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with ability and intelligence, with knowledge and all craftsmanship, to devise artistic designs, to work in gold, silver, and bronze, in cutting stones for setting, and in carving wood, to work in every craft." Father, you have released over these people the Spirit of God to give them ability and intelligence with knowledge in all craftsmanship. Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that every willing vessel in this room, every open heart, Father, would open their spirit to you, to new things, to new adventures, to new levels of revelation and wisdom, not just the revelation to get it, but the wisdom to walk it out. Father, I release upon everyone in attendance that is in agreement, everybody online that is watching that is in agreement, Father, I release upon them in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, Father, give to them the spirit of creativity. Father, I pray for new things, new ways of doing old things, new streams of revenue. Father, release the spirit of wealth upon them, not just finances, but peace, wholeness, joy, health. Father, make them a people of a Renaissance movement, Father. Release creativity, God, over your people. Let them not shrink back from doing big things, but let them run headlong into what you're doing, Father. Let them run full bore, Father, into creativity, into witty inventions, Father. Give them new ideas, Father. May they be good steward, God, of the seeds that you're depositing in their lives. Father, may they arise and shine in a prophetic day and age, in a prophetic movement. May they say yes to your spirit and what you are doing now. May they get over themselves, Father. I pray that you would anoint their minds, their hearts, their ears, Father, their mouths. Anoint their eyes to see you high and lifted up. God, anoint their hearts to know the heart of the Father. God, I pray for the rest of this weekend for a spirit of expectation. God, that people would come even more hungry. Thank you, Holy Spirit. If you're in this room right now and you'd like to step into a deeper level of prophetic understanding, I want you to lift your hand to the Lord. Yeah. Just come up here. Come up here. We're going to release this over you. I know I said we weren't going to release anything on you, but we are. We're calling out ability that's already in you, but I want to release you. And as you step up here, that's an act of faith. That's you stepping into what God has for your life. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Yep, just come up. Just line up. I've had leaders speak into my life that have led the prophetic movement in America and beyond for the last 20 years. I've been fortunate and blessed to have people pray for me and bless my life and speak into my life that were generals of the faith in the prophetic movement. And I have, for the last 20 years, paid a price in the place of prayer, receiving the wounds of the prophetic for your benefit. With every hand raised and eye closed. Father, such as I have, I give to them. Father, such as I've sacrificed, such as prices that I've paid in integrity and to do what you've called me to do, Father, such as a trail that I've blazed, Father, I give it to them. Gladly, Father, I pray for a double portion anointing on their lives. Father, give them a double portion anointing of what I walk in. Let my ceiling become their floor. Father, raise up oracles in this room. Father, let them prophesy mysteries I could only dream of. Father, I pray for a spirit on their life of conviction to walk out the prophetic mantle that's on their life. Let them not shrink back from shame or abuse or the words of man that would delay. But Father, let them step into the fullness of their callings right now in the name of Jesus. I give you permission to arise and shine. You will not be punished for prophesying. You will not be punished for trying to please God. And to those of you that are up here that have already stepped into the prophetic and you've been damaged by church leadership in the past, I release you from the wounds of being misunderstood. I release you from the baggage of being misunderstood. And I say, you are welcome here. This is your tribe. God is your tribe. If you've been abused by the prophetic or manipulated by the prophetic, I release you from the wounds of that in the name of Jesus. You are released from the trauma of being manipulated by a prophetic voice that was not a prophetic voice. I release you from the wounding and the trauma that comes from a Jezebel spirit that mimics the prophetic, that tried to take you out in the name of Jesus. Father, bestow upon everyone here, God, the spirit of Jehu to run swiftly and to tear down the works of the enemy. Father, let them champion love in the name of Jesus. May they wear love like a banner on their arm, God. May they wave it over every relationship they have. Anoint them, Father. I pray for new levels of revelation. Open up their dreams, oh God. We pray for an open heaven over your sleep in the name of Jesus, that you will have encounters from the Father. This next season of your life is all about visitation. Father, carve them out. You're looking for riverbeds, God. You're looking for riverbeds, oh God. carve out these riverbeds, oh God. God, these will be vessels of the new wine, Father. Let them be vessels of the new wine, God, that will break the striving off the church. I pray, God, for a grassroots kingdom army to arise out of this conference, out of this weekend, for people to step out of baggage, out of drama, and out of trauma, God, into new things, into better things, that they would be bigger than their setbacks. In the name of Jesus, Father, in your name we pray. Amen. Y'all may be seated. Thank you, Jesus. This is not a one-time prayer. I want to say that as you're making your way to your seats, this is not a one-time prayer. You got to pray this thing out with the Lord. I ask him daily that I would be filled, that he would give me opportunity to speak into someone's life. I am so excited for tomorrow morning and tomorrow evening and Sunday morning and Sunday evening. We are going to have a rich time of prophetic ministry. We're going to give you all a chance tonight. We did the giving this in the beginning of the evening. That was for the monthly support, but we're going to pass around. Do they have baskets or what? How are we doing it? Yep. Okay. We're going to have the ushers come forward. If I could have the worship team keep playing. They're just going to pass the offering around. This is to go towards the event as well. Everything we're getting in this weekend is going towards this event to bless the speakers, to bless the church and everybody that's helping along with this. Please search your heart and give. Please. I'm asking you to join us in what we're doing. This is not a little thing. This is a big thing, and we really need people to join us. There's other ways to give. I don't know if they showed those yet. They did? Okay, great. So there's other ways that you can give online as well, through Venmo or through the websites. But we're going to pass. Ushers, go ahead. You can start passing those buckets down. We got those fancy white buckets. Don't wait to give to get your word. Sometimes at these conferences, people are like, I'll give once I get a word. Don't do that. Give out of a thankful heart to what God's already going to do. Out the same way we came in. I want to go out honoring the Father in worship. We're going to do a song again, and I just encourage y'all to stand up. We're going to go in as a community, and we're going to worship the Father. Now come tomorrow morning and tomorrow night with a level of expectation. Don't throw in the towel tonight out of greed because you didn't get a word. I know sometimes it's easy to go, well, I didn't get a word. I'm not going to go the rest of the weekend. I usually don't prophesy the first night. Come with expectation. God's going to speak to you. God's got direction for people in this room. Don't miss out on it. I want to break the cycle of conference goers. Okay? God has amazing things for you and big things for you. Amen? All right, worship team, you take us there. We're going after the Father right now. I want y'all to just have your hearts in a posture of worship. We're going to go after heaven. And when we're done, when we're done worshiping, we can adjourn. We'll see you out in the lobby. We love y'all.